you want a vision of the future, Winston, imagine a boot stamping on a human face forever.
They will run you dizzy. They will pile falsehood on top of falsehood until you can't tell a lie from the truth and you won't even want to. That's how the powerful keep their power. Don't you read the papers?
The world is a college of corporations, inexorably determined by the immutable bylaws of business. The world is a business, Mr. Beale.
It has been since man crawled out of the slime.
Welcome back to another episode of Our Interesting Times. It is my pleasure to have Cynthia Chung on the show. She is a lecturer, writer, and co-founder and editor of the Rising Tide Foundation based out of Montreal, Canada, correct?
Yes.
Okay. I guess you posted, we're here to discuss, I guess, four articles that you wrote last fall, October through December, regarding Aldous Huxley's Brave New World. I guess the titles are Who Will Be Brave in Huxley's New World, The War on Science in the 20th Century, Descent of Man, The Origins of the Counterculture Movement, Gathering of Anarchists, Occultists, and Psychoanalysts for a New Age, and I guess closing it out with Huxley's Ultimate Revolution, The Battle for Your Mind, and The Relativity of Madness. That was in December. These are posted at the, at least I saw them at the Strategic Culture Foundation.
Correct. Yeah.
Okay. And what is the Strategic Culture Foundation?
They're basically a think tank in Moscow, and they've just been publishing a lot of the Western writers. They basically provided a platform because it's been increasingly difficult to support yourself as a writer that isn't going along the mainstream line. So, they've been just very successful at accommodating a platform for, alternative voices. And they actually have a very impressive list of writers that contribute to them that have a lot of experience. I kind of wonder how I ever was accepted as a writer for them, because I my credentials are so much lower than the average contributor for them. But I'm very happy that they've given me the opportunity.
Yeah, in the past few years, I guess as the West becomes, I guess more, corrupt and more oligarchic,
a lot of censorship.
Yeah. And so they're baring their teeth, and maybe too much information got out in the past 15-20 years, and now they're having to engage in open censorship. Of course, what they'll say is they'll accuse you of being an agent of Putin or something if you don't toe the NATO line or something. These pieces on Aldous Huxley and his work, The Brave New World. Who is Aldous Huxley, and what was his Brave New World? What is his Brave New World, actually? It's not. I think we're living in it now, so go ahead. I'll let you take it from there.
Well, I guess I would ask you, Tim. I mean, I think that a lot of people regard Aldous Huxley's Brave New World in the sense that it was a warning of what kind of future we would be living in if we didn't hearken to certain to certain adjustments that he was basically asking us to do. So that's pretty much the impression I've had from people, is that they regard Huxley as a good person, a well-intentioned person. And what I did with the series, I didn't actually expect it to be so long as a four-part series. I thought, honestly, that I would be able to do this in one article. And as I looked into the matter further, I realized how incredible all of the connections around Huxley were. And that, I mean, at this point, I'm actually thinking about writing a book, because it just goes on and on and on. Like, there's so much research still that needs to be done. But I would say, just as a recap for people who might need a refresher on Brave New World, the main theme for that I took from it was that Mustafa Mond, who's the ultimate, you know, the highest architect that we get to meet, but he's not the highest of the highest. We never get to meet that person, right? He's one of like about 12 controllers that have an ultimate leader that they have to respond to. And I use quotes from Mustafa Mond in most of the papers to kind of pinpoint primary messages, really, that Aldous Huxley wants us to get out of the Brave New World. And there is some frankness to it, but he doesn't disagree with what Mustafa Mond is ultimately saying. He, I think, kind of identifies with the Mustafa Mond type character. And so one of the primary themes of it is this idea, first of all, of truth and knowledge versus comfort and happiness, and also truth and knowledge versus like the idea of purposefulness, intention, versus basically just toting the line. And I would say that a lot of people would probably see a lot of similarities with this sort of way of thinking nowadays. That's also why people think that Huxley is so prophetic in his Brave New World. And it really, I think, for people to have the most clear understanding, they have to start with Aldous Huxley's grandfather, T.H. Huxley, who is known as Darwin's bulldog. And this whole thing with Mustafa Mond very clearly saying that in the sciences, you know, there's like a scene in Brave New World where Mustafa Mond is correcting some person's scientific paper that they have sent to him. And he thinks the paper is brilliant, but it's ultimately heretical because it's challenging the mainstream line, which, you know, anything in the sciences will ultimately have to make some kind of challenge, right? If it's a new idea, if it's a new discovery, you're not usually going to have new discoveries that just kind of fit neatly into some kind of pre-existing compartmentalization. And so he has to reject the paper, even though there is this potential for good, this creativity that can be useful for society. Ultimately, it's judged to be too dangerous because it challenges too much the status quo, and it acknowledges purpose. And the thing about a scientific dictatorship, which very clearly the Brave New World is, and, you know, Aldous Huxley doesn't shy away from that, or that it's a scientific caste system, is that you can't have a concept of purposefulness in a scientific dictatorship. You can't have an idea of intention. And that's where very clearly T.H. Huxley comes in, with the support of Charles Darwin's work on, you know, the supposed discovery of evolution in the way that he defined it. And what I go through in part two. Part one's pretty much an introduction to the series, and part two is really the first paper. What I go into is that you can't have basically this concept of what Darwin put forward was that there was not going to be any purposefulness to the identity of mankind anymore. It defined nature, it defined the universe that we were in as random events that had no causality, and that ultimately humankind was akin to just a beast. And if we have the concept of ourselves just being beasts, it means that, you know, this concept of truth, this higher purpose, is not really real, and comfort and happiness become more a priority for such an identity. It also means that certain things like eugenics are not really unjustified at that point. If you start looking at yourself and other people as just mere beasts that don't have control over, they don't have good judgment, they can't be relied upon, they're not responsible. And so we need to set up, you know, certain parameters, certain adjustments to ensure that we don't make a mess of the future. So I don't know, do you want me to just continue on, or did you want to add maybe a few thoughts to that?
Well, it seems to me that someone like Darwin is being promoted, and also Huxley, ideas being promoted to sort of ratify or support a social caste system, and also the, sort of the economic system that those who were running the British Empire were setting up at the time. This justifies the opium wars, exploitation, slavery of many forms, not just the chattel slavery, but also the wage slavery of the you know, developing industrial age and exploitation, what the British were doing to the Irish. And it also justifies the whole, you know, Reformation, which is the plundering of church property and justification of that theft. And so it serves the interest of the British, the sort of the upstart British aristocracy at the time. Mm-hmm. So you can see how they were trying to develop this sort of cosmology, which is a return to pagan cosmology and a rejection of a Christian cosmology with these ideas. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I think that Aldous Huxley and I believe Julian Huxley for certain was also an atheist, but Aldous Huxley was very interested in Christian mysticism, but he was an atheist. And the reason why he was interested in that, and I totally agree with you that like Darwin was the first kind of, not even end of religion, it was really the new religion. It was the modern religion. H.G. Wells writes very openly about the need for a modern religion. So they don't, even though there is this popularity of atheism that comes in the 20th century, H.G. Wells, Bertrand Russell, Aldous Huxley, they're all part of the same grouping. They all recognize that the general populace, they still need a religion to abide by. And in H.G. Wells's Open Conspiracy, H.G. Wells was mentored by T.H. Huxley, by the way. And then he, in turn, served as a mentor of sorts to Aldous Huxley. So did Bertrand Russell. And H.G. Wells writes in his Open Conspiracy, the need for a modern religion, which basically strips away any concept of a relationship to a creator, a benevolent creator of the universe, strips away any kind of judgment of morality or goodness. And really, it just comes down to blind subservience. And he really says, like, you don't even have to, you should not have any thought. It's not even about believing. You just need to blindly submit. And so that that was a focal point of Aldous Huxley's studies with Christian mysticism, because, you know, mysticism is a complicated subject. I'm not saying that all mysticism necessarily is bad, although I have to say I don't quite know the good forms, although it seems like there possibly could be from certain things that I've like very quickly looked into. But mysticism, the problem with mysticism is, and this is where I go in part four, sorry for skipping around for people who haven't read the series, but the problem with mysticism is that if you don't have a firm foundation of understanding already, mysticism is just going to annihilate your ability to understand anything. And it will be very similar to this blind subjugation that H.G. Wells is asking for. And it's, you know, the bad kind of mysticism is just emptying the mind, and you are kind of a vessel. It's just a cathartic experience. It's just a physical experience. There's no mental processing at all. And by doing that, looking into the history of Christian mysticism, but even other spiritual religious mysticisms, even tribal forms of this, which William Sargent was also looking into, that you have this increased suggestibility that occurs in these states. And that's where the highest effectiveness for manipulating the mind, manipulating the belief structure, what motivates a person, can be most effective. Because Aldous Huxley had come into, I would say, close correspondence with William Sargent. They've mentioned each other many times. Like, Aldous would mention him frequently in his lectures, and William Sargent mentioned him frequently in his Battle for the Mind. But that was William Sargent's core study, because, you know, with Pavlov's discovery of how to manipulate typically four different nervous systems in dogs, it was found from the Pavlovian results. There was this fear that, you know, you could have the Manchurian candidate, that you could just empty a person's personality and reintroduce a new personality, and that this personality could be a cold-blooded assassin. And, you know, like, with one trigger word, this person would, you know, become a completely different person. And I mean, that was obviously not accurate with like how Hollywood was portraying it. And I think Hollywood was doing that in order to justify a lot of the freaky experiments that were going on very much around the Tavistock Institute in England at the time, using soldiers from World War II that were suffering post-traumatic stress largely. And then I think, you know, later on they were using patients from asylums, but they were really trying to see how you could introduce a new, like a clean slate, a new identity. And they found that it was actually really hard to do this, and that free will was actually a huge component to this. So no matter what kind of, you could say, forms of torture, like sleep deprivation or insulin therapy, or that's not really therapy, but, you know, all of these types of ways of like breaking down a person physically so that mentally they will have increased suggestibility, it still wasn't working very effectively if the individual didn't have an illusion, at least, of free will. And so they found that it was best to utilize certain kind of parameters that would give that illusion. And so, yeah.
I know, it's a big topic.
It's a lot. Yeah.
I know, you mentioned William Sargent and Tavistock. And of course, again, Tavistock was created, I think, going back to just after World War I, I think. under the pretense of studying, I guess, treating soldiers who had what they called at the time shell shock. Mm-hmm. And it developed, and rather than it developed an interest not so much in trying to cure shell shock, it was they took a keen interest in noticing the effect of the nervous system that, you know, that explosions that you had at the front in World War One had an effect on people. And they realized you could break these people down and simply destroy their personality and rebuild them. And instead of looking ways to cure that, they thought, well, hey, we can weaponize this. And that's when all the research started looking into all this stuff. And MKUltra itself was a program begun in the 1950s, the CIA. And I think the excuse for that was the fact that the communists were doing it. In fact, you see that in the Manchurian Candidate movie, right? The Chinese are doing it, evil communist Chinese. But it turns out, you know, that was just a pretext or a pretense for these experiments.
Yeah.
And then you had the Macy Conference with Norbert Wiener. Mm-hmm. This gets into the whole cybernetics and the development of the technologies that would be used. Of course, the advent of television, mass communication in general, these things would be applied to that in the 20th century. That was sort of the force multiplier to these things in the second half of the 20th century.
But that's why I think that it's a really important thing for people to have sink in, is that there is something really good, and it does have a power. It has a significance in the individual. We're told nowadays that the individual is insignificant. It is mediocre, but in fact, it's not true. And the fact that even William Sargent himself had to acknowledge that free will was a major component to this tells you something about our nature already, that we are not just like a computer program, for instance, that you can just, you know, wipe clean and reintroduce another program into, but that we are creatures that have to identify with the purpose that we think we have chosen for ourselves and the moral parameters around this. Now, that doesn't mean that people can't be corrupted. People are corrupted all the time, but they're corrupted through a false ideological belief or through a false motivational belief. So that's where the most effective forms of influencing people's thoughts and minds, like brainwashing, isn't so much like the extreme sorts of fantastical things we see in movies, but really it's the educational system, it's the cultural system, social media especially. I feel really bad for the young people right now, because it's especially hard now to resist the kinds of things that you're constantly being exposed to,
especially with lockdowns and
things. Yeah, that too. It's extremely hard for the younger generation, and I am concerned for them, because like your concept of reality is so much more controlled than it's ever been through certain forms of stimulation that you're receiving, and so. That's the thing, is that we ultimately still have to choose the ideology, the identity, the motivations that we abide by. And we can always change those things. So there is a certain fear, the fact that there's so much effort being put into these things shows that it's very important that they have a certain control over this, because if people were able to kind of reflect a little bit more on what exactly has created the structure of their identity and their motivation, or even their fears — fear has now become a really big thing as well in terms of controlling people — then, it would be a lot harder. But that's the thing, is that there is something actually really good in people. And I realized that with this series, that that wasn't something that I was able to go through as much as I wanted to, because for one thing, you know, there's only so much I can put in an article. There's a word limit and so forth, but I do want to write follow-ups. Like this is pretty much going to be a continuous thing for a while for me, sort of on this theme. But I do want to write some more uplifting articles for people, because I don't want people to think that they're disempowered by the situation that we're in, and that to have knowledge of how the forms of control work is really to hopefully have people gain insight into how much they have, how much they have a role to play in terms of not abiding by that. And it's not as difficult or as scary as people would think. But anyway, to go back to this idea of purposefulness. So Darwin himself.
One thing
Is
this one thing I read Aldous Huxley, and is what strikes me is sort of his misanthropic view of things, and yes. And how basically it's sort of a circular reasoning, how the scientific dictatorship is necessary because people are so dumbed down, they're so stupid, and they're so driven, you know, by their appetites. But then he supports a system which caters to that instead of edifying, uplifting people, because mass communication, the internet, mm-hmm. television can be used for benevolent reasons. It just hasn't been.
Exactly.
A good example is the 1950s. If you look at some of the programming, I think it was Bishop Fulton Sheen had a show where he sat in front of a chalkboard and gave lectures on theology and philosophy, and it was a top rated show in the country. And it beat Milton Berle out, who's a comedian wearing a dress, cross-dressing comedian. Then it switched, the TV switched. And of course it switched because they gradually introduced more, I guess, alluring imagery, and, you know, they introduced sex and controversy, and that's always very interesting. Of course, what they did with the movies too in the 60s when the production code collapsed. So, I mean, this isn't necessarily malevolent. Just like the internet, there's some really good uses to the internet, like our conversation tonight. The research, like I said, the past 15, 20 years, what I've learned accessing the internet has fundamentally changed my understanding how the world works. I think it's actually more accurate how the world works. Mm-hmm. So it hasn't drawn me into a false reality where it has a lot of other people. So these technologies can't be used for good. They just haven't been. So...
yes. And it's as an individual, you can't expect to be fed the truth nowadays. So you do have to do work. Mm-hmm. And you do have to spend some time in researching. And I agree, the internet right now, although I'm a little bit worried about these types of things, like the fact that you can get books, a lot of books on the internet, especially the older ones, for free. You can read, I read a lot of my research. I don't even have to go to a library. I can just get it off of the internet. So it has its uses, but also the fact that there's a certain centered control is a little bit concerning,
yes.
But for certain, that's the thing. Well, Aldous Huxley is a tragic personality. You know, in The Island, which is his last book that he wrote before he died of his throat cancer. So he knew he was dying. He was diagnosed with this throat cancer, you know, at least a year or two before he started to write The Island. And he says in Aldous Huxley, also, for those who've read several of his books, you'll know that he is not very good at creating characters. And he will always, the characters in his books are always people he knows in his life. And the main character in The Island very clearly shares a lot similar to Aldous. And, you know, at one point the character is thinking about the common people, you know, like the 9-to-5 grind where you have to take public transport or whatever. And he goes through thinking of everyone as a kind of worm, and they're just like a nothing because their life is empty. There's no meaning to it. You're just subservient to whatever. But then he corrects himself. The character even corrects himself and says, you know, that's not really fair to say that about people. And I think that kind of says a lot about Aldous's character, where he goes through these really extremes in being very misanthropic and very cynical, but at the same time, he knew on a certain level that that wasn't really fair with how he was characterizing people in general. But the problem was is that he couldn't see a solution to what he had. I mean, he didn't really stand a chance, because it was like his entire family from T.H. Huxley on had this viewpoint that the world was doomed if we were to have just the common people breed, because they were going to take over the gene pool, and they were going to take over the resources, and there would be nothing, you know, left for us. So there had to be an intervention. And the question was, how heavy-handed did the intervention have to be? So in Aldous's mind, I'm sure he thought he was a pretty humane interventionist of this sort. The thing is that Aldous Huxley himself was, I would say, almost undoubtedly considered a failure in terms of what was expected of him. And Julian Huxley had much more, I would say, serious responsibilities, but part of it you could say is maybe because Aldous lost his eyesight, you know, when he was in school still, but he never quite amounted, and his there was a middle brother between them who committed suicide, by the way, over part of the reason was just the stress of being a Huxley. It's like, it's an amazing amount of pressure that a lot of these like people go through. Eaton, which is notorious, like George Orwell also went through Eaton, by the way. Like, nobody comes out of Eaton, it seems, intact and a fully functional, healthy person afterwards. I don't know what did they do to these kids, but
trauma-based,
it sounds horrifying. It sounds like a Lord of the Flies experience and then some, but mixed with Bohemian Grove. And
well, there's probably a lot of sexual abuse, things like that.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Oh, yes.
I've heard, you know, we've all heard of, you know, English school.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a reason why I think that homosexuality is so prominent in, you know, the children who go through Eton and then onto Oxford or Cambridge or so forth, is that, you know, it's been shown that if you've had that kind of sexual abuse young, you tend to, you know, showcase it more as an adult, and it's encouraged as well. And the professors also encourage that kind of relationship and so forth.
Well, this is the Bloomsbury set, right? I mean, this is like Lytton Strachey and, the idea of the higher sodomy and this weird, you know, these ideas that they, you know, this is right after, during World War One, I guess, and it was Lord Keynes, to another one whose contempt for sort of, I guess, for patrimony, his contempt for responsibility showed in his love of his economic theories. When he was confronted with the, I guess, the contradictions of his economic thought, he said, well, in the end, we're all dead anyway. You know, so
yeah.
He didn't really care. So it's almost like this fatalism. So it does affect the psyche,
right?
And it does matter if these people are in positions of great power too. You know, if you're designing the global economic system for the post-war era, these personal problems might have an effect on it. So,
you know. Well, that's the thing, is that the more you look into these personalities that have a certain amount of responsibility, the more you realize how dysfunctional everybody is. And it really is an incredibly dysfunctional family. Like, even Julian Huxley was subjected to electroshock therapy. Like, Julian Huxley had several nervous breakdowns in his life. And at one point, when there was a bombing that was occurring in London, and he was in a hospital, I think, before one of his nervous breakdowns, they had to, you know, ship the patients to another location because of the bombing. And he was I guess, somewhat hysterical, and they did electroshock therapy on him, and he described it, you know, as the it was so painful that he passed out. So like, even these people who are supposed to be, you know, the creme of the creme in some ways, at least the creme of the creme of the servants, he was subjected to electroshock therapy as well. Like Alan Dulles subjected his own kids to MK Ultra, the MK Ultra program. So it's weird. Like it's a really, really dysfunctional, and nobody is like, I think, fully in control or has like a super clear idea of anything. It's more of an obsessive ideology. But to make the point of what you were saying in terms of a dead universe, that's exactly what I make a point in part two, is that with Darwinism, the main points that created what we can say is modern science, and what really has shaped certain like rules that you cannot break if you are an academic at this point, is the idea that nature, the universe, is governed by random events. And that number two, we have no soul, there is no God, and we are equivalent to beasts. But what that also opened up for was in the early 1900s, it was, I believe, Hilbert who spoke at the first conference. It was a mathematics conference, high-level conference, where he was saying that, you know, for the beginning of the 20th century and on, we would be able, he put forward the challenge that all knowledge should now be able to be put into basically mathematical models, mathematical formulae. So we can now just explain everything in a sort of computer language, you could say. And that this old school way of investigating causality was now moot. We didn't need that. And Bertrand Russell, along with Alfred North Whitehead, they worked on the Principia Mathematica as kind of the Bible for this this process. And even though it was disproven by Kurt Gödel, it was extremely influential to this day, and opened the door to, you know, the cybernetics and systems analysis situation that we are in today. And one of the really big components to this was that the universe, our relationship to the universe at this point, was inconsequential, and that the universe was to be regarded as something now that was like cold, detached, dead or dying. And, you know, if there was any purpose, it was not a purpose that we had any place in. So the best, you know, that's very much like what is behind that you can't know any truth, because even if there is a truth, you can't know it, because us, in terms of being sensual beings and so forth, that's what we're told, we can't know. We can't have the ability to understand higher truths. Now, the more you look into this, the more it very clearly is just a program of like how to teach someone to be a good slave.
Yeah, yeah.
And that you're ignoring very clear processes of your mind. Hopefully, now again, the younger generation nowadays, they don't have a lot of time to have that very critical self-dialogue, self-reflection, where you can have an ability to have a discussion with yourself, which is part of the process of hypothesizing. And hypothesizing is not just something critical for science, it's critical for everything we do. And you have to constantly kind of readjust your hypothesis in life, because whether we like it or not, we have to have some kind of foundation in terms of how we define our reality and our relationship to things. And we do have to have like some kind of concept of purpose, even if it's an extremely low purpose, a materialistic purpose. You have to have something that keeps you going at the end of the day. So this is what has been attacked with this modern science. And again, H.G. Wells then, I mean, it was totally orchestrated so that once you had the modern science, which disproved God, then there was the opening for a new religion without God, or maybe we could create that God later on, sort of thing. But that religion is never quite fully explained by H.G. Wells and his open conspiracy, just that we need to submit ourselves to it. And Darwinism was a huge component of that religion. Like nowadays, it's not that we are a completely atheistic society. Nowadays, religion, or I would say pseudoscience has become the new religion, because people believe in it blindly without actually asking questions and without looking into what are anomalies, what are the paradoxes, what are the contradictions to things. And nothing is ever perfect. So to say nowadays we say like certain sciences are just perfect and we cannot criticize these sciences, which that was never the case before. And like we most certainly are not at the top of our game. Where I mean, basically to say that you can't criticize any kind of science is to say that you have absolute knowledge. That's an insane insertion for myself.
Well, it's also a presumption that the practitioners of said science are incorruptible, which is absurd. Because then a cursory look at the institutions like NIH or CDC or World Health Organization or the various universities, and it's corrupted all types of, you know, moneyed interest, the big pharma, the banking, Bill Gates, you know. So, you know, you've heard the expression, I believe in science. Well, remember, science isn't supposed to be an act of faith, right? But nevertheless, yeah. They say, but I believe in science. You believe it, okay?
Yeah.
That's an interesting word choice there.
Right.
It's become a substitute religion, yes.
Exactly. I don't know how much time we have, because we've kind of taken a lot of time on part two, but part three goes into the certain occult connections that Aldous has. Do we want to go into that quickly, or what do you think?
Go ahead. That's because that will play into the 1960s and the counterculture. But the one thing is, it's interesting that Aldous Huxley's sort of pessimistic view of things, of the Huxley family, is sort of they accepted, you know, the ideas of Thomas Malthus, who developed the idea, you know, he thought that overpopulation was going to overtake food production, and his theories were demonstrably proven false in the ensuing centuries, as that isn't what happened. Nevertheless, you look at the industrial age, some of these families like the Rockefellers, they set up an economic system within and of itself are not sustainable or full of internal contradictions, like the banking system, and you have, you know, periodic collapses and booms and bust cycles, and you know they developed this addiction to petroleum when there are alternatives to these things that could have been much more sustainable and much less of a damaging effect on the environment, less extraction. Good example, the suppression of ethyl alcohol and also when they banned hemp, you know, in the early part of the 20th century. These all have wonderful consumer industrial uses, but they wanted to promote plastics, which are more problematic from an environmental standpoint. So a lot of these, again, the problems that Huxley and they're looking at, this goes to like the Club of Rome and Bill Gates and Klaus Schwab, is they set up a system which is designed to collapse, and they set themselves up as the people with the solution after the fact, you know, the Great Reset. You know, well, if you created this world, why are we following your prescriptions? You know, it's like, and who anointed you? But it is funny, they do create this world of, you know, of overproduction, of planned obsolescence and blind consumerism. Then all of a sudden, can't sustain it anymore. We have to have a Great Reset and steal more of the world's resources, you know.
So, well, it was considered part of a stage of an ultimate goal. So we were entered into a consumerist society for several reasons. And one was that it was an economic booster for, and made a lot of people rich that should not have become rich, but it was also a corrupting influence. But now we're at a stage with this Great Reset agenda where we don't need a consumer society. And that's why we see the kinds of policies that are coming now, which seem very paradoxical, or they seem nonsensical, really. Like, why would we do something like this? Obviously, it's going to make the economy collapse. It's going to create an unsustainability on a mass level. And it's because, I don't mean to scare people, but they don't believe that they need a consumerist society anymore. So now we're on the next stage, which is transhumanism, cybernetics. It's starting to get into the Borg, but they also don't need so many people anymore. I would say
isn't there a book called Why the Future Doesn't Need Us or something, or Need You or something?
I'm not familiar with that book, but interestingly, there were a lot of people at the beginning of the 20th century that actually was aware of this plan that I didn't realize like how big of a topic it was even at the beginning of the 20th century. James Burnham is a negative example of that, who was a very close collaborator with, not collaborator really, like the assistant of Trotsky, who also became the father of neoconservatism. He wrote The Managerial Revolution in something like 45 or 46, I can't remember. No. It was even earlier than that, right? It was still when World War II was going. And he is also talking about how we are going to go past this this consumerist society. We're basically going to be moving into a technocratic society. And you know who else recently I've discovered who's been talking about this? C.S. Lewis.
Interesting enough, C.S. Lewis, Aldous Huxley, and John F. Kennedy all died in the same day. November 22nd, 1963.
Yeah, I know. That was a big day. I don't know. It is a weird coincidence. But C.S. Lewis, he wrote a trilogy, which the last one of the trilogy is called That Hideous Strength, which I'm reading right now. I haven't finished it. I'm halfway through it about. And he's totally also predicting so much of he's warning, but he's like a positive warning. Aldous Huxley is basically like, you know, this is going to happen whether you like it or not, and this is, you know, the way for you to adjust so that there's the least amount of suffering, or so he thinks, right? Whereas C.S. Lewis is genuinely warning people about this in his book. I mean, there's also other elements of fantastical in it for like metaphor, I would say, but he very clearly he says technocratic society, and he clearly identifies a whole bunch of the problems in terms of where science is headed in its priorities and what it's willing to compromise on in terms of ethics and morality for the larger cause, right? Which is for anything, like whether we're talking about governance or the sciences, whenever you think that you're justified in making very large sacrifices for what you think is the overall good, it's never the way to achieve any kind of good. But unfortunately, you know, that's something that has succeeded and something that we have to face with an immediacy now. Anyway, so for part three, to get back onto the Huxley story, it's a lot. I myself have to do a lot more work in terms of everything that ties into this, but there's this basically this society, bohemian anarchist society that also has prominent psychoanalysts that are coming into this in Ascona, Switzerland. And Mikhail Bakunin, who is like the leading international anarchist, was kind of a pre-founding father of this sort of bohemian grove of sorts. And later on, it has prominent members like Otto Gross, which was a disciple of Freud, who ultimately brings Carl Jung into it. Otto Gross ends up having to be treated by Carl Jung and just starts talking about Ascona and brings Carl Jung into it. And that's what actually caused Carl Jung to have the break with Freud. He wrote The Psychology of the Unconsciousness, and he, you know, introduced the religion of sun worshiping and all of that. That this is all stuff that he got from Ascona. And you can read my part three on this, because Otto Gross is a horrible character. Like, he actually encouraged the poisoning of at least two of his patients. And he thought, you know, if the improbability, if cure was improbable, then it was better to have a beautiful death. And it seems like these women were aware of it. He was just encouraging suicide by having like poison by their bedside. But I don't know if it went further than that. And you had people like Hermann Hesse around this, Rudolf Steiner, Kropotkin, like really big names that were all coming together at this Ascona. D.H. Lawrence, who's a mentor of Huxley, and they're all kind of like getting this weird anarchist mixed with psychoanalyst education, and then going their separate ways. And so D.H. Lawrence would form his own kind of weird philosophy, I guess you could say, or they say like Lorentzian metaphysics. And that's also a lot to get into. I mean, it's really bringing back a lot of pagan stuff, and Bakofen is brought into this, who has these like four stages of the human development, and the last stage is considered the solar stage, which is the Apollonian, and that's where the sun worshiping comes in. And this has a direct crossover with the Ordo Templi Orientis, which also sets up its headquarters in Basel, Switzerland, but also in Mont Verita under the Hermetic Brotherhood of Light. And so you have Aleister Crowley that eventually takes control of this. You know, he's the one that introduced the law of Thelema, which is do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. And that was basically, it's a continuation of this anarchist kind of vein of this philosophy of living. And by the way, Otto Gross, interestingly, he wanted to set up a school, possibly in Ascona, which was to, the raison d'être was to destroy Western civilization. And what I mean by this is like the Christian traditional, like, teachings, you could say, or, you know, the certain classical educations of the Western civilization, because he thought that that was at the root of the dysfunction of Western civilization. And Max Weber, who is a sort of co-founder of the Frankfurt School, wanted to fund Otto Gross for this endeavor, but Otto Gross started to really struggle with a drug addiction, and he was going in and out of asylums for like over a decade. So he wasn't in a position to start anything.
So naturally, you want him prescribing and telling how the world how to govern itself. Well, didn't he also believe that basically freedom, or at least the way to approach life is just indulge every appetite, every impulse. Yes, now, of course, anyone knows if you do that, your life and those around you are going to be a wreck. Nevertheless, they try to, I guess, develop a philosophy around this that also would follow Aleister Crowley's view of life, do what thou wilt through the law. And of course, he himself succumbed to his appetites too, drug addiction and these things. But he also would victimize the people around him. But this is sort of a Luciferian doctrine they're preaching, you know, which maybe explains the antipathy towards, you know, Christianity. Is this is so destructive, it's self-evidently destructive. It seems only only a group of intellectuals who don't have to worry about raising a family or paying the bills could indulge such a thing. And maybe they're funded by somebody too, perhaps, you know. So
it's I don't fully understand like what exactly was motivating Otto Grost, but he's really cynical. And you know, one of the things he's recorded as saying when he was in the asylum was that he wanted to die at 45, ideally in an anarchist assassination of someone. And instead he died.
Hope I die before I get old, I think.
Yeah. Well, he's known as by many as the grandfather of the counterculture movement. And instead he died at 43, a few days after being found on the street, like half frozen, having gone in and out of asylums for many years with drug addiction. And that's the thing, like you just do what thou wilt sort of motto, which he clearly followed. And it was a horrible life. And very much the punk rock scene that it really does follow, like, that kind of a philosophy. And for some reason it's romanticized, and it's like the people who can like hold out the longest, like we're supposed to respect those people, like Keith Richards. Mm-hmm. I mean, this guy, he does have amazing endurance, I have to say, incredible endurance, but it's not something, you know, that we should be respecting. Instead, you know, we should be horrified by such things.
Well, I think he said, one interview said, if you made the deal I made, you want to put off the death as long as possible. So, so.
Oh, he's saying because he sold his soul to the devil.
And Bob Dylan has said similar things in interviews. Yeah. So that goal goes back to the whole Robert Johnson mythology, right? The crossroads, selling your soul for stardom, you know?
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, well, you know, I'm sure Keith Richards did some crazy stuff. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so Crowley gets into this, and I'm just thinking of how to. So basically, D.H. Lawrence is the mentor of Huxley, and he also, like, with Gerald Hurd, as well as very much influenced by D.H. Lawrence and Christopher, I'm forgetting his last name now.
Isherwood?
Yes, thank you. Christopher Isherwood. And they're known as like the Sonnenkinder, which is the children of the sun. And there is a lot of crossover with this idea of the children of the sun, because at first it sounds, that doesn't sound so bad. The sun, like, that's pretty. By the way, they played major roles in forming the Human Potential Movement and the Esalen Institute, which I'll get into right after this. But actually, this whole Aryan sun worshiping religion that came out of Ascona and also has a lot of overlap with the Theosophist Society under Madame Blavatsky, there is this idea of the solar angels, or what they call Agnishvatas, sorry if I'm saying that really badly, because they're starting to borrow a lot from the Hindu philosophy, but they were really banalizing it, and they were trying to use these things to act as a kind of false, you know, twisted religion. But it was a religion of spirituality, right? Like, it wasn't a religion of the church. So it was much more free, was much, you know, that's basically, you know, how we're told about these things. And Alice Bailey, she wrote her esoteric psychology, which continued Madame Blavatsky's work on this. And she makes the point that basically you have to bring in the darkness in order to have the light shine the strongest from that star of Lucifer, because Lucifer is considered one of the fallen solar angels. I believe Madame Blavatsky is the one who started this mythology of like this interpretation of it, that that Lucifer is one of the solar angels, thus they're one of the children of Lucifer, right? The people who identify themselves as the solar angels, which again goes into the Bacchophon solar stage and all of this. So
it also sounds like a, like maybe would inform what would become process theology.
I'm not familiar with that.
I might be wrong about that, but the idea was that the good and evil, there's a process there. So in order for good to exist, it must be evil. Therefore, evil isn't evil.
Oh, right. Yes.
They relate to one. Yeah. You know, this Charles Manson gets into this stuff and gets into
little
counterculture stuff, because you know that you lead up to.
That's the thing about Charles Manson that I couldn't fit into this series, but that the Agape Lodge number 2 is formed in Los Angeles in 1935 under Crowley, who's now the head of the Ordo Templi Orientis. And it is the founder of Scientology, what's his name, Hubbard, L. Ron Hubbard. He ends up coming into the Agape Lodge, and he's interacting with Jack Parsons, who becomes like a big player in the Agape Lodge. And he later on leaves this, but he's always a follower of Crowley. And then he forms his Scientology movement, which uses actually a lot of psychological techniques that were later on used by MK Ultra and so forth. And Aldous Huxley, who...
So the auditing, right? The auditing process.
The auditing, yeah. I forgot the exact title he had for this like form of... I don't know if you want to call it psychology form or whatever, but there was something to it. I haven't looked too much into it, but there's definitely something to what he was looking at.
One thing that's interesting, get all these characters, and excuse me if I come across as crude, but it seems to me that a lot of this stuff is just designed so people can have a lot of sex and get laid. I mean, that's right. L. Ron Hubbard and Jack Parsons, weren't they like fighting over girls a lot?
Parsons' partner, right? Because he was originally married to a woman, and then he starts to have an affair with her sister. Yeah. And then that sister ends up falling in love with L. Ron Hubbard, and she runs away with him. And he abused her terribly.
Uh-huh.
Like, really, she had a horrible life. So, I mean, yeah, so much for do what thou wilt. Shall be the whole of the the law, and your life will be great. Like,
yes,
it has not worked out for most people. But L. Ron Hubbard, you know, he's very high level. Scientology, the kinds of techniques that they used for people who wanted to leave Scientology were the kind of stuff that the CIA was studying. I mean, they were linked, but he wasn't separate from that sort of thing. But they were studying the kinds of techniques that he was coming up with. But anyway, what's really interesting is that Charles Manson, when he was going in and out of prisons for a good deal of his life, and then at one point he's introduced by a figure in prison teaching Scientology, and he went through a crazy number of hours of auditing. I can't remember how many, but a lot. And then he comes out, he's basically allowed to break his probation and go to another area that he normally wouldn't be. He comes under the directorship of someone who's under an LSD program lab, mm-hmm. but also happens to hold a certification to be a probation officer. How quaint, right? I mean, obviously, people who are coming out of prisons, and then he's working for an LSD lab, but also can oversee prisoners. I think we can link the two together. And Charles Manson was doing a whole bunch of things that his probationer officer was aware of, like encouraging people that he was bringing into his mini cult at the time to do prostitution and all sorts of things to gain money. But he was even breaking the law, and he was taken out of jail. He was even arrested and imprisoned at one point for, I don't know if there was some kind of car accident that he was in or whatnot. And normally, in normal conditions, with someone that is under probation, you would be kept in prison, especially with all this unstable activity around this person that is being acknowledged. But instead, he's taken out of prison. And I'm not sure if that happened more than once. And then, he was allowed to continue on with what he was doing until eventually that tragic night where they butchered a whole bunch of people. So it was clear that there was a lot around that was they were waiting for that kind of a certain kind of outcome, and they were grooming Charles Manson. There is rumors that he even visited the Esalen Institute, although there's been a lot of pain to erase that. I don't know. Maybe it wasn't erased. Maybe he never went there. The Esalen Institute, it's such a big rumor that the Esalen Institute has even said, gone out of its way to say that he has absolutely no relationship to them. But he most certainly does have a relationship to Scientology and being overseen by, I forgot which university it is, that was working with a LSD experimentation. And he was going under LSD experimentation with them as an unstable personality. So there's that. That's also connected with all of this. But yeah, so this Children of the Sun, they all go to Hollywood. Aldous goes to Hollywood in 1937 with Gerald Hurd, and Christopher Isherwood 2 years later. 2 years later, Crowley forms the Agape Lodge number 2 in Los Angeles in 1935. So Hollywood is very much a prime target. And in part 4, what would I say are the main highlights? Well, I don't really, I think, have time to go too much into the Theosophist Society. I go into Krishnamurti and how he's a fraud, and so is Alan Watts. And you can read part 4 if you want to know more. Basically, Aldous Huxley, when he gets into Hollywood, he's a completely failed writer. He wants to be a successful writer for Hollywood, but he cannot write. Like, even Brave New World, by the way, was largely plagiarized work from Bertrand Russell. Some people also say it's from Evgeny Zhuy, the Russian writer. I haven't read Zhuy, so I have no idea, but Bertrand Russell was apparently so upset that he was writing letters to his editor for his Scientific Outlook, saying that, you know, Aldous Huxley plagiarized major components of this, including the drug with no headache and the banning of Shakespeare and so forth, that he was considering making a public, you know, accusation of Aldous, which his editor dissuaded him from doing. So, you know, Aldous brags that he did Brave New World in, like, I don't know, 4 months or like something very short like that, but it was really not his own work. And he was never able to do anything that amounted anywhere near that afterwards in his life. He's a complete failed writer in Hollywood and so forth. And I would say he's kind of an embarrassment, you know, to the family legacy. He could never amount to the ambition of Julian Huxley, and not the ambition, the status of Julian Huxley, who is a much higher level player. And even with meditation, it seems like him and Gerald Hurd were, when they came to Hollywood, possibly taking the whole meditation thing seriously. They were visiting the Vedanta Society frequently in Southern California, but he could not attain that. Gerald Hurd was claiming that he had been able to attain that. You know, I seriously doubt that as well, but I think that Aldous Huxley was feeling really frustrated. And so when he came across these studies with William Sargent as well, and then Humphrey Osmond with the LSD, he saw, you know, a legacy for himself. And again, there's a lot of tragedy with Aldous Huxley. Yeah, he just ended up kind of being a sort of guinea pig himself, but very successful in, because he was an abiding guinea pig to it, to introduce it to the population en masse as something that it really wasn't. And he himself even, you know, was claiming that for the people who understood, you know, who had the ability to attain the secret knowledge through this kind of cheat, you know, the shortcut through using LSD yeah. or mescaline, that you could attain it. But he never attained it. He never attained it. And that's why he was so afraid on his deathbed. He had to take massive doses of LSD in order to, you know, be, I think you would say, somewhat dignified in death. I think he was scared to death of death. That wasn't really maybe the best way to put it, but, you know, he was really scared of that. And the island is all about that. It's really focusing on that, because, as I said, he knew he was going to die from his throat cancer. And it really puts into question of, you know, what not only the meaning of your life was, but what is afterlife. And the Tibetan Book of the Dead, which is something that I don't know how this was introduced to Aldous Huxley, but again, I see him being a bit of a pawn in a larger scheme, because the Book of the Dead was something very important to him. Again, it was a central component to the island. And it's said that his second wife, who was a psychiatrist, who's a scary woman, forgot her full name, but did controversial work with children as well. But she was reading the Tibetan Book of the Dead to Aldous on his deathbed. And it was believed that, you know, if you read this to the person, it would help them reincarnate properly. The thing is that the Tibetan Book of the Dead, which is the Bardothodol, sorry for my pronunciation, it was translated into English. And from my knowledge, that was the only English translation that was accessible at the time, maybe even to this day, I don't know, was from Evans Wentz, who was from Oxford, an Oxford archaeologist, who was sent to the Orient by none other than T.E. Lawrence. Oh. And yes, for those who don't know who T.E. Lawrence is, it's Lawrence of Arabia, British intelligence. And Evans Wentz was not specialized to have any understanding of Tibetan Buddhism or even Buddhism in general. But interestingly, he was a theosophist. He was part of the Theosophist Society, which, again, I haven't had enough time to talk about it in this discussion, but people can read the papers for more information on how this fits into everything. Clearly, what is the claim by some is that he took a lot of liberty in his translation of the Bardothodol. Now, knowing that he's associated with British intelligence and he is also a member of the Theosophist Society, you can imagine the kind of liberties that are being taken in translating this so-called sacred, you know, document or book. And that Aldous, it seems, really was following this. And he later on passed this on to Timothy Leary. He spread this also to everyone, that everyone needs to read this book. And he even wrote his own book that was very much centered around this interpretation of the Tibetan Book of the Dead. So, you know, it for me, it makes Aldous Huxley look like a bit of a stooge. And he was a useful stooge. He was a high level stooge, but that's a thing that we have to realize with these people, are that they don't have the kind of loyalty even for their own in some ways as you would think. And it's brutal. There's nothing, as C.S. Lewis actually makes the point in That Hideous Strength, that this character who really wants to get into the inner circle, really wants to be included into this inner circle and for like the inner knowledge, the secret knowledge. And when he finally gets there, he's completely horrified and wants out. And he's like, oh my God, this is insane. You're all crazy. I would rather have never have like known how you think. I think that there's a lot of truth to that. And, you know, C.S. Lewis himself was a part of Oxford and had a chair at Cambridge. And I think he was aware of some very bad avenues that these universities were a part of.
Yeah, it is interesting that that type of, weaponized anthropology, is the term.
The British are masters at that.
Yeah, and the Americans picked it up, Gregory Bateson, and idea of studying, you know,
right,
a culture, these things to
right
to
and Margaret weaponize. Mead, his wife,
Mead, who again, this is another example again that studying their own personal life have an effect on, you know, their supposed science or their studies. And she's the one that developed Blue Lagoon anthropology, or sociology, I think. But the idea was this was to justify, you know, idea of free love. And of course, it turns out it was all a lie. Those people on the island there, but it was justifying her own lifestyle. She was having multiple affairs and these things, but it wasn't done so much to expose Americans to what was going on in Samoa. It was to justify the sexual revolution to Americans in the West, which was being ushered in the 1960s, to bring about, you know, certain demographic changes in the country. These things that, you know, obviously this is the same time introducing birth control and promoting all types of degenerate behavior with the counterculture. Right. And the counterculture, again, is being steered, being promoted. Demographics have a big part to play with this, because at this time you have the baby boom generation, which is coming of age in the 1960s, going to college in record numbers. And because it's the same time that the Frankfurt School is populating the universities, installing their people throughout the universities. So it's an explosion university system. So they're riding that wave. And again, you mentioned Hollywood and popular entertainment and television coming to its own at this time. So you could really do a lot to steer the culture in a certain direction if you're if you're predisposed to do that.
And then R.D. Lang comes in, who's working for the Tavistock Institute, and you know, redefines what is sanity and what is insanity. And he is actually one of the people who works very closely with the founders of the Esalen Institute, who were inspired to do this and were in close communication with Aldous Huxley and Gerald Hurd, the Human Potential Movement. And their first seminar from the Esalen Institute is some version of the title Human Potential Movement. So it's very clear that, you know, And the Esalen Institute is an incredibly high level player. Like they're even involved with like Gorbachev and, you know, US-Russian relations. It's like, it's all like really strange, but they were promoting really, at the time people didn't know about it as well. And I think that's why they made it public. Now you can only access it with the Wayback Machine. But they were promoting the works of Loretta Bender and B.F. Skinner and Ewan Cameron and Jolan West. They were openly promoting these people who were like torturing their so-called patients as a beneficial treatments that, you know, we should all learn from. And then there's also the occult factor of the Esalen Institute, which they keep more hush hush. But in terms of the psychological psychiatric revolution that they wanted to see come forward, it's very clear, you know, what kind of thing that they wanted, and the whole like NLP neuro-linguistic programming also very much came out of the Esalen Institute. So this comes very much through the Ascona process, like the certain characters of that very much go through into the Frankfurt School, the Esalen Institute, to shape what now, you know, it started to become normal for most people to have a psychologist at some point in their life, right? Where they had to just like see a psychologist for a certain amount of time. Mm-hmm. There was a redefining of like what was normal and what was not normal. So unfortunately, you know, people who wanted to avoid the inhumane practices of psychiatry and psychology that were prevalent, you know, 19th century and so on, those practices were not really any more humane, although they were given the veneer of that. They just, you know, were like less judgmental, I guess you could say, of like what was maladjusted. But that's not really helpful either, you know, when one thinks about it, because maladjustment can be a normal reaction to a sick society. That's yeah. True. Mm-hmm. However, you know, it's not to glorify the maladjustment. It's to fix the sick society.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, that's what you mentioned in the article, but Ken Kesey, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, where mm-hmm. it glorifies, you know, insanity. It's the rest of the world, you know, basically mm-hmm. it's crazy or vice versa. But the idea is that the world is insane, you know, mm-hmm. And that's sort of a fatalistic view of things. Whereas let's identify what's wrong and fix it and improve it, you know, instead of mm-hmm. saying, well, the whole world's insane. So, you know, just to do your own thing, whatever. You know, and get a lobotomy at the end of the movie, I guess. But they create the insane world, and then they wonder why people have problems adjusting to it, and then they call that the insanity. You know, mm-hmm. And if you again you look into some of these people who are designing the world, whether it's John Maynard Keynes or whether it's the Huxley family or some of these elite families, the Rockefellers. And these banking families, the Mellon families, which again, another interesting connection to the counterculture movement was the Mellon banking family.
Mm-hmm. Which were big supporters of Carl Jung.
Yeah, odd alliance there. You know, why are they funding the Grateful Dead and Timothy Leary? Mm-hmm. But, because it also goes back even Gordon Wasson, who was head of, I think, PR for JP Morgan Bank, was a part of MK Ultra Project, I think it was Subproject 58, which was publishing an article in Life magazine promoting psychedelic drugs. Mm-hmm. And this is 1957, 10 years before the Summer of Love. So they're priming, getting everyone kind of conditioned to this 10 years before. But that shows that the alliance between banking and the, publishing with Time Life and Henry Luce, and also CIA. And so this is when we talk about CIA, we're talking about in concentric circles. So basically it was the banking financial system which created the intelligence agencies. So it's not surprising that, you know, they would have these people going in and out of these positions, coordinating this stuff, whether it's what's being produced in Hollywood or what's being promoted in the media and what's being promoted in the culture in general. It's what Life magazine and was all about. Mm-hmm. But this goes back against secret societies like the Skull and Bones, which formed OSS, which became the precursor for the, you know, for the CIA. So they represent a certain class of people. And if you talk about some of the rituals you hear about occurring at Skull and Bones, you know, that sort of Bohemian Grove perversion, weird stuff. You're like, wait a second, these guys are running the world. You're like, whoa, you know, wonder why the world is so troubled. There's no wonder. Yeah. You know,
well, I mean, that's the thing, is that like they're definitely they're controllers. There's like a Mustafa Mons, maybe at best, you know, controller. And then there's always the architect, the maybe few very small grouping of architects. But that's also what the Esalen Institute was for, right? It was not for controlling the masses. It was for controlling the elite. So you know, like leaders of countries, people who had like a certain station that had a lot of responsibility, but at the same time, they were not fully in charge. And they needed a controller. They needed NLP techniques to control them so that there were certain, you know, kind of pathways you could push someone towards, or you could even say personalities you could push someone towards with certain types of stimuluses. And I mean, it's not so Frankenstein or like, you know, fantastical as something you might think in a movie, but you know, we all have, you could say in a subtle way, multiple personalities in the sense that, you know, you have your personality for work, you have your personality with your partner, you have your personality maybe with certain friends, your personality with other friends, your personality in professional when you're relaxed, when you're blah, blah, blah. So there's these like, they're not, very different from possibly your core personality. Maybe I think with some people it probably is, depending on the kind of line of work you're in and all of this. But for these people who have larger responsibilities, that's kind of like all they know is projection, and so it's becoming the controller of their projections. And they tend to not have a very stable or very well-defined core personality. These are actually the best people for these kinds of, you know, puppeteering, like the Prime Minister for Canada, for instance.
Yeah.
so they're not like fully formed personalities. They don't really actually even quite understand what they're in. And the Esalen Institute was to be an international controller of that sort of thing. But, you know, they're tied into a lot of other stuff as well. And also like really controversial work with children. But all of this is like from T.H. Huxley until this point in the end of the part four series is to not only have us lose consciousness or an attachment to a higher identity that we all have access to, but it's also to break apart the family, which the Brave New World as well, it clearly, you know, says that you should not have a family. You should not even have a concept of parents. It should be ideally regarded as repulsive to have the concept of a mother. By breaking apart these core things, it makes it harder for us to have an anchor in moral values, and also for us to want to fight for something, because if we're all divided, it's harder to have an idea of what to fight for, because if everything seems to be so well controlled, and there doesn't seem to be really a more beautiful, higher meaning to anything that we're in. Why struggle? Why not just go along and try to be the best you can? Try to be an alpha plus, you know, at the end of the day.
Aspire to get that higher, the inner circle or higher level.
Yeah, the favorite slave. You can be in the class of the favorite slaves.
There's a lot of reward, immediate reward for that, and there's a lot of immediate pain for fighting it. And that's how they get people to go along with it. You talk about, you know, how do you manage or train these world controls? Just, you know, a good example would be the Rhodes, Cecil Rhodes and the Rhodes Scholarship, right? How this is a training way. People, these are administrators or clerks for the empire, and the whole worldview and a closed system is developed, how the world is governed, international relations and these things, London School of Economics. Mm-hmm. And everyone thinks, it isn't to say there isn't a parameters allowed for disagreement within that circle, but at the end of the day, they all agree about certain precepts or general concepts. So they can't, this is why someone like Mustafa Mann, a character, would think the way he thinks. He thinks he knows it all, right? He understands he's one of the controllers, but he's been trained to think a certain way. So he thinks in this very misanthropic, static view of things, you know.
Well, he even says, right, which I think is, kind of showcases how Aldous probably also thought, which makes him, again, tragic, is that Mustafa Mon said, I also was like you once, you know, to John Savage. And he's like, but I learned that basically resistance was going to lead me nowhere. And he had the choice, he says himself, to either be shipped off to an island or to change. And he decided that he would change, and he became a controller instead. So, you know, there's a tragedy in this. And I think that is something that is within these personalities as well, these personalities that are aware that they're a part of something that is really hideously unnatural. But the problem is that they can't think of a winning alternative. And that's the lack of their creativity and their ability to problem solve, and also their faith in anything good. If you don't have faith in anything good, then ultimately you are going to be subservient to what is in power in the now. And that's, again, a thing to stress. If you don't know what is something that is a powerful alternative in the good, you will always be subservient to the power of the now, no matter what it is. And James Burnham showed that too, in terms of his terrible prophesying and his managerial revolution, where at the time he thought the German Nazis were going to win, and so he was speaking nicely about them, and then he realized they weren't going to win, and so he started to speak nicely about the Russians, and then he realized that they weren't going to win, and then he became a neoconservative.
They get on the winning team, right? And
you got to be on the winning team.
Then it changes. It's like, you get it so wrong, why are we listening to you?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, but it's almost like, again, it gets back to Christianity, whereas not the desire to, but the willingness to be a martyr for something bigger and better. And that's, if people are willing to die for something, die for a cause, even take a risk for a cause, not necessarily die for it, but it's to throw it out there. Meaning, we all know that in our personal lives, I mean,
risk discomfort.
Well, that's something, is the idea of doing away with pain and struggle. Well, everyone knows that it's only through struggle and adversity that we become stronger and healthier and we grow. So it's completely contrary. And this old idea of the Christianity, where there's sanctification through suffering, and of course the message of the crucifixion and these things. And so this, I think it ultimately speaks to these people's alienation or rejection of traditional Christianity, which leads to their embrace of Luciferianism and ultimately their despair, as someone like Aldous Huxley would.
Yes. If you're always fleeing pain, you're going to be the greatest, subject for manipulation.
Yeah.
You're the easiest controlled person ever if you're always fleeing pain. And, again, that's something that C.S. Lewis made the point of for the main character who wants to be in the inner circle. He said, this person received a modern education. They never received a classical education. They didn't have the shrewdness of a peasant nor the honor of an aristocrat. And with any, hint of a physical harm, they would be knocked over by that, and they would try to avoid it at all costs. So, if you have a population that is of that, you're not going to have any kind of resistance. You can basically impose anything with just a little bit of force, even, and they will step in line.
Yeah, the past 2 years are an example of that, right? Fear of death.
Yes.
Just the minute risk. Of death. It's also on risk because we take risk and just stepping out our front door every day. Ironically, even with this whole COVID stuff, everyone's at a much higher chance of being killed in a car accident than dying from a virus. Nevertheless, this virus gripped everyone, mm-hmm. made everyone fearful, and it actually shut down society regardless of the collateral damage.
It showed where we were spiritually, because there's such a fear of death that people couldn't think of the quality of life, and that you need to live your life with honor and dignity, and also to keep, certain things sacred. Mm-hmm. And if you're willing to sacrifice all of that to extend a life where you're basically just watching Netflix during lockdown, it means nothing.
Yes. And all the time, that's actually making you sicker and less healthy. And you're eating poor, you're not getting exercise, not getting vitamin D. They're telling people to do this. And that's so much exposes the corruption of our public health system right there, when they're telling you, giving you advice, which is so counterproductive to basic health.
Yeah. You're not allowed to work out at the gyms. And even during the springtime here in Canada and Ontario, they tried to pass a mandate where a cop would be able to stop anyone walking on the street at any time of the day, asking them why they were outside of their houses. And luckily, the Toronto police had refused that within less than 24 hours.
So that's where the human, again, you speak to that human quality reasserting itself. They're not just machines. Yeah.
Yeah. But can you believe that? Canada is not very populated, by the way. We have the population of California for all of Canada. And you're telling people that they can't walk outside and get a bit of sun.
The reason why there's cold and flu season. The reason why there's cold and flu season is because people have vitamin D deficiency.
Yeah.
And that's another thing. It wasn't, not to mention what they've done with the food supply and, they're promoting modern life, which is an unhealthy lifestyle. And wonder why people have all these chronic illnesses, which have skyrocketed in the past 40 years under the guidance of our public health authorities and our these experts. And then they're going to tell you that safety comes through at the end of a syringe, as opposed to exercise, dieting, and you're so fearful of death, you can't go to church. I love that. I'm sorry, I had my mute on. Hey, so is there anything else you want to cover? I think we covered it.
I think that was a good way to end it. What do you think?
Yeah, it's good. I think that's good. We're up at an hour, I guess, almost an hour and 40 minutes. That's good. Okay, great. So let's see, where are we here? Let me close this out. Okay, so the articles are Who Will Be Brave in Huxley's New World? The War on Science in the 20th Century Descent of Man. The War on Science and the 20th Century Descent of Man. Yeah, I'm sorry. The Origins of the Counterculture Movement, a gathering of anarchists, occultists, and psychoanalysts for the New Age. Huxley's Ultimate Revolution, the Battle for Your Mind and the Relativity of Madness. They're all at that is at the Strategic Culture Foundation, right? That's where they're posted?
Mm-hmm.
And that where our people should be directed to read those articles?
Yeah, or they can go onto my Substack page, which is A Glass Darkly, and then you can just write Cynthia Chung, and you should be able to find it no problem. And I post things every week on that Substack page, which includes the Rising Tide Foundation content as well.
Okay, and I guess you post what you've, if I recall, when I talked to your husband, that you have like weekly lectures there or something you can listen to?
Yeah, we have, right now we're doing a symposium, which is going to last for about 2 months from now, which is on storytelling, myth-making, and the shaping of universal history. And we're basically just going through very influential writers who have shaped for the good cultures and just thoughts of I would say positive impetuses that are international, cross-cultural, but we can always identify a universal theme in that, which is always something we like to do at Rising Tide.
Excellent. Okay. I'll post this soon. I'll send you the link, and I'll also provide a link to all those articles so listeners can go and check those out. And I guess they'll expect more on this topic in the ensuing months.
Yes, I plan on writing on this vein of investigation for a few months now. Yeah.
Okay, great. Well, thank you so much. It was a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you.
I'll let you go. Likewise. And salvage some of your evening. Thank you so much.
All right. Take care.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye.